6:30, Dr. Mike Holloway coming to you with an evening report from Ouachita Baptist Church. The theology report, you've heard of the farm report, you've heard of the business report, you've heard of the finance report, you've heard of the Hollywood report. This is the theology report. And we're glad to come to you from the New Fellowship Hall of Ouachita Baptist Church. So we're talking this week about the Passion Week, last week of Christ before crucifixion. Before we get started, I just want to tell you how much I'm missing all of you. I know you're missing each other. We're excited to see a bunch of you up here Sunday morning. This Sunday morning, you want to make plans to be here, 10:45. Share this, pass the word around. Many of you know, Brother Whalen, Miss Roxy is still kind of sick with the coronavirus. Brother Whalen is still coughing a lot. Last night, he and I were talking and trying to come up with a solution, what to do for this big production this Sunday morning. And I suggested, I think we ought to call the Lisby family and see if they're free this Sunday. And as it turned out, they were. And the Lisby family is going to be here with us. They're going to do all the music, maybe share a little bit. I'm not sure what all they're going to do, but I know they're going to take care of the music portion of the service for us. They're going to pull it here Saturday evening and set everything up. We don't have to watch the weather. We do have the FM transmitter where we can plug it in, and if it's raining outside, you can leave your windows up. We'll take you to tune in to a certain radio station, and you can listen to it in your car while you drink coffee. And if it's sunny and clear and not raining, we're going to set up out under the drive-thru. They'll sing from there, and I'll preach from there, and it's going to be a great day. And you don't want to miss it. A lot of special things. But that's going to start at 10:45. We're not going to have Sunday school. We're not going to have any Sunday school. Everybody just put all your eggs in that basket of being here at 10:45. And when we conclude Sunday morning, we're going to have the Lord's Supper. We're going to have communion. It's all going to be done sterile. We have individual juice packs that's sterile. We're going to have bread individually wrapped, all done with gloves, and everything is sterile, so there's no danger of anything passing or germ passing to you. And, some way, depending on the weather, we're going to pass it out through windows. Nobody's going to be allowed to get out of your car, so don't get out of your car and walk over and visit with someone else. But we may have a way to pass it to you through a window where you reach out and take it. If it's raining, we're going to have to drive through the drive-through, and we will have it where you can receive it at the drive-through. So there's just a lot of things we're trying to do for this week, and we hope that you'll be here. It's going to be a special week, Easter Sunday morning, 10:45. We're looking forward to you coming. Liz became again with us and made it a special day. And I mentioned to them that we would love to come. We didn't have anything planned. All their events have been scheduled, had been canceled. They had on the schedule, so we're glad that they're going to be with us. We still haven't made the decision on the revival. We're going to wait till probably the 14th of this month to see what how the virus is going, and whether they're going to try to open back up the economy a little more in May. We're just going to wait and see. We don't have to be in place. We have decided to probably look like we're going to work on vacation Bible school in a while, more than watching. The mission trip is still scheduled for July, the last week of July. And, I talked to Brother Cam, and he's trying to make plans for a youth camp this summer. And so, just keep us in prayer. We're all not used to this, just like you. And so, it is a different time. But God is good. We're still praying, still checking on our senior adult folks. And if you do, thankfully, not many folks have lost their jobs. But if you need assistance, our church needs assistance, we want you to know, let us know how we can help you. Can you run an errand, pick up some medicine, however we can help you, we want to be available to do that, okay? So you let us know what to do. This week, the Triumphal Week, is really a week that symbolizes a week of victory. And in the midst of this COVID virus and all the fears that are out there, well, this is a victory week. Just like World War II, it was V-Day. V-Day? Was it V-Day? V-Day Day? I forget how they said it, but it was victory. It was a victory for the Allies. And that's what we should see Easter as, a time of victory, a time of God overcoming the world. And you find things could have some fear. But remember, God's going to overcome it. We are in His hands. Listen to this story. I want to read to you about the triumphant entry of Jesus approaching the city of Jerusalem and how that he, the messages, I want you to see the messages in this story today. Some of you may be familiar with this. The story of Jesus riding in on the back of a colt, a young donkey, is in all four of the Gospels. Maybe a little bit told, a little different perspective and different viewers, but it's in all four of them. I'm using Luke chapter 19 today. Luke 19, beginning in verse 28. Here's what it says. When he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem, and it came to pass that when he drew near to Bethany, at the mountain called Olivet, that he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village opposite you, where, as you enter, you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat." Now that's unique when he says that. It's what's called a virgin colt. If you've ever ridden horses, I remember my dad one time telling me to hop on the back of a young colt that we had, and when I got on his back, he took off running. And it wasn't long before he went one way and I went the other way. They're not used to that way on their back. And that's what this colt was. And so it says there, he said, when you find that colt, no one does sat on, you can loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, "Why are you loosing this?" Thus you shall say to him, "Because the Lord has needed it." For those who were sent went their way, found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, "Why are you loosing the colt?" And he said to them, "The Lord has need of him." And they brought him to Jesus, and threw their own clothes on the colt, and they set Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. And then as he was now drawing near to the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice. Praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they have seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." But he answered and said to them, "I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stone would immediately cry out." The scripture goes on to talk about as he got closer to the city, he left there, "Let's see." All I think is God loves his people. God loves all people. And if he's left, he's left because he saw what was coming for him. You read those next verses, he said, "Oh, if you had just known, even and especially in this year's day, the things that make for your peace. Now they're hidden from your eyes. Days are coming upon you, and your enemies will build them and brush them around you, and close you in on every side, and level you in your spirit and begin to the ground." He saw drastic days coming for the Jewish people. A lot of it was because of their rejection of God's plan and law. As we look at this story today, we'll pause for a prayer. Father, as we read this scripture about the triumphant entry of Jesus into the city, it seems so normal, it seems so casual, not important, but yet there is great meaning in this text of scripture. So much so that all four gospels include this story. Tell us today, Lord, what it means. How can it speak to us? How can it challenge us? How can we learn deeper to respect your love for us and our calling and our commitment to you? So speak today is my prayer, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. beginning of the end, I call it. It's the beginning of that final week. My mouth is dry, I have to take a drink every now and then, but the beginning of this week begins simple enough, but the Lord, as he enters into the city, he has a plan. He has a statement that's being made. He's coming into the city, and there's just so much symbolism in his entrance into the city. In my back, behind me, you can see the screen. I tried to make it more visible today, and you can take a few notes if you'd like. What is the Passion Week? Well, we've learned that defining the Passion Week is so named because of the passion with which Jesus willingly went to the cross in order to pay for the sins of his people. Passion Week begins with the triumphal entry on what today we would consider Palm Sunday, on the back of a colt, as was prophesied in Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9. Isn't it amazing that the prophets even saw Jesus coming in riding on a colt? And this was, by the way, a young donkey. Now, even that happened. We'll look at it. The Old Testament prepares us for this great day, this great event. As I said, Zechariah 9:9, it says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." And so, even back there, Zechariah the prophet told them about this day that would be worthy of great challenge and blessing. The king is coming to you, he said. A lot of people don't realize it, but Jesus literally was of the lineage of King David. He had a rightful claim to the throne of Israel, and he chose to go that route, but he did not. Jesus came in there, and basically by riding in, he was showing he was under the authority of the prophets. He was under the authority of the throne. He could have been made a king. Some actually wanted to take him and make him a king. But that wasn't why he came. He came to be a suffering servant. He came to be a lamb. He didn't come to be the lion of the tribe of Judah. He didn't come to be a king. He didn't come to be a great general. The Bible tells us why he came. It's a fulfillment of the prophecies of Exodus chapter 12. Here's a couple of verses 2 and 3. If you want to read it in good time, that whole chapter talks a lot about the Passover feast. And it was time for Passover. This was Passover Passion Week. It's basically Passover week. It's a preparation for the Passover. What is the Passover, you ask? Well, it goes back to Egypt. It goes back to when the children of Israel were captive in Egypt. You may remember that 10th plague was that they were going to have a death angel, or death in some format, was going to come into the city where they were, and it was going to destroy all of them. Well, that was the last thing they wanted. And God said, the way it won't destroy the oldest male in each house is if you go out and you do what this says for them to do right here. Look what it says. It says in verse 2 of Exodus 12, "This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb according to the house of his father, a lamb or a household." And did you know that Jesus, this Passover feast, did you know that in Jesus' life, he fulfilled all the feasts up to the time of his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension? And he is going to fulfill the rest of the feasts. He's going to fulfill the Feast of Trumpets. When the trumpet sounds and he comes back, I believe it's going to happen while the Feast of Trumpets is going on in Israel. The tabernacles and all the other feasts that are going to take place. After that, he's going to fulfill all those feasts. The Feast of Pentecost fulfilled that by the coming of the Holy Spirit. So we look at all these things today, and Jesus here is fulfilling by his life, by giving himself as the Passover lamb. What is the first? It says this on the 10th day of this first month. Well, that first month is the month Nisan, N-I-S-A-N, or Aviv. It's referred to two different ways. This Passover week for the Jewish people usually the same, or close to the same week as our Passion Week, which is Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday. And this Palm Sunday, you'll see, it gets that name from when Jesus is riding into the city. They're waving palm branches and as an act of worship to him. It's like a king coming back from a great battle and just won great victory. And they're celebrating that great victory. Well, here, before the crucifixion, before the resurrection, they're celebrating this victory that Jesus is that victory. He is going to overcome the world. Okay? And so it all begins in that first month in the Jewish calendar, the month Nisan or Aviv. And so the 10th day of that month Nisan or Aviv, the lamb, it says there in Exodus 12, the lamb is to be brought to the temple, and it will undergo 4 days of inspection. They bring it on the 10th day, they examine it closely for 4 days. In fact, you'll find the first 4 days of this, right after Jesus rides into the city, some of the most trying times, the traps, if you will. They try Jesus. They try to trap him every way they can. And you know what they're doing? They're really examining him. Because what would happen when people would bring their lambs in for the Passover sacrifice, for 4 days they would inspect that lamb. Every detail. Because it tells us here in Exodus 12:5 why the priest had to examine that lamb and see if it was an acceptable priest. You couldn't bring a sick one. You couldn't bring one that was crippled. You couldn't bring one that had a bad eye. You know, you had to bring one of your best. And it had to be one of your best. So they had 4 days to go through all these lamb sacrifices, and Jesus was being examined the same way. In fact, you may remember what Pilate said. Remember, after Pilate investigated and asked him all the questions, he washed his hands. He said, "I find no fault." He had been investigating, and then there was no fault. Exodus 12:5 says that lamb should be without blemish, had to be a male of the first year. Okay? On the 10th day, when everyone was bringing their lamb to the temple for examination, you can see all this is on the screen. You're following me. While that lamb was being brought to the temple for examination, Jesus was riding his colt to be examined by the Pharisees. He was making himself available to them to see, and here's a man who could claim the throne, a right to the throne, but he's not. He didn't come, again, to take political power. He wanted to increase the power. And so that's why Jesus came. And so here he's going to be examined. And don't forget Jesus, the Lamb of God. As John the Baptist said, he would come and he would take away the sins of the people. The Lamb of God, John the Baptist. And so Jesus is God's lamb. Here he is while everybody else is bringing their lamb in for the Passover sacrifice, which, by the way, could do nothing but cover their sins for a year. He couldn't forgive their sins. He could give them another year of covering for their sins. But Jesus' sacrifice on the cross as the Lamb of God would take away our sins forever and ever. There'd never be a need for another sacrifice. On the 14th day, the lamb would be sacrificed for the sins of people who brought that lamb. Now, based upon the Jewish calendar, theirs is more of a lunar calendar. So it can be a little time, a day or two off, a few days off from our calendar, the Gregorian calendar. And you have to remember, a Jewish day is different from a day that we would, like we see it in the Gregorian calendar. Remember this, for a Jewish day, it begins at 6 o'clock in the evening, basically at sundown, and it goes to sundown the next day. So when a day begins, it's at sundown, and it ends at sundown the next day. So when you start counting these days, I know there's a lot of people say, well, if Jesus came in on the 10th, the 5th day of the month, and that was Sunday, then 4 days later would have been Thursday. So he must have died on Thursday. Well, I'm not going to say that's not even possible, because it may be possible. But if you count these days the way they're counted in the Bible, that Thursday, that day that we would look and say Thursday, You have to realize Jesus was brought in. He was beaten. He was abused. The process of his life being taken lasted several hours. And it lasted that whole night as he was tried by Pilate and Herod and different ones that he was talked to. And as they eventually decided to crucify him, it turned dark at noon. The whole sky was dark. And he died about 3 o'clock. And remember, when he died was before Passover. Now, Passover will start at Friday sunset and go through Saturday sunset. So Jesus had to die before sundown on Friday. But would we call that Friday? Because is that really considered the day before? Is that considered a Thursday? Because it started on Thursday sundown. So it's all a matter of how you count the calendar days. It's a matter of which day. I've heard people argue, no way, he had to die on Thursday. Well, how do you count those days? Different from our calendar. I'm not going to take the time here today to get into that argument. That's not what I'm about. But I think it's pretty clear, it's easy for you to see that he's brought in at the time the other lambs were brought in, because he is our Passover lamb. He gives his four days and he's inspected. First thing he does is go to the temple and run all the thieves out of the temple, turns over the tables. Because he's also doing some inspection during that time. And gives them a chance to see what's really important to them. And so verse 6 says, you keep them until that 14th day of that same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it and follow it. Now, I also understand that in Peter there was also a national lamb that was placed out to be watched by the people, and that there would be a national lamb that would be killed on that day too. I don't know a lot about that, but I do want you to understand that it's the same principle, but every person's individual had an individual lamb that they gave. If you were poor and couldn't have a lamb, there was other things you could use in place of that. But you had to make an annual atonement, Passover type sacrifice here to remember what happened in Egypt. To remember how God delivered them and how death passed over. And so Jesus is reminding them, while they're all doing the Passover feast, he's going to have the Lord's Supper with his disciples. It's really the Passover feast. But he's tying the Passover feast into the Lord's Supper and making sure that they understand he is God's Lamb. And his blood is going to be shed for them. And his body is going to be broken for them. Just as that lamb was back in Exodus chapter 12. And they were to do that every year to remember what God did for them in the Passover. After the lamb was killed, the blood was placed on the altar, and they would have put some on the doorpost back in Egypt to cause death to pass over. Exodus chapter 12, take some of that, put the blood on them, put it on the two doorposts, and put it on the lintel of the houses where they eat. Everyone took some of that blood from that lamb, and they put it around their door. And that was to let God know, when death came by, let God know this house is covered by the faith and the blood. Faith and the power of the blood. And death was passed by. So my friend, the Bible says that you and I can pass from death to life. We don't have to experience that second death. I love this saying. If you're born twice, the water birth and the newborn birth, the spiritual birth, if you're born twice, you don't only have to die once. You won't have to experience the second death that Revelation talks about in hell. But if you're only born once by water, and that's the natural birth, and you don't experience the second birth in Christ, then you're going to die twice. You can be born twice and only die once, or you can be born once and you're going to die twice. Never forget that. I don't know about you, but that second death, eternity in hell, is a fearful thing. And I can't imagine anyone wanting to be a part of that. As Jesus was celebrating Passover, he was giving himself as our lamb. He was celebrating it with his disciples. They took communion there, the Lord's Supper. And we celebrate drinking that juice. It's how Jesus, as they drank that wine there, was telling them, this is a sacrifice. I'm giving myself for you now. Paul writes about it over in 1 Corinthians about the meaning of that blood being shed for us as a payment for our sins. And the second death would then pass over us, the scripture teaches, and give us eternal life. This blood sacrifice is what Jesus was keeping when he offered himself on the cross for our sins as our Lamb of God, as our sacrifice for the sin. So just like they put blood of their lamb on the doorpost to keep death to pass them by, if you'll put the blood of Jesus on the doorpost of your heart, God says that second death, that eternal death, will pass you by, and you'll pass from death under a sentence of death. If you're not saved today, you're under a sentence of death. The Bible says the wages of your sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And if you'll place your faith in Jesus Christ, you don't have to experience that sin of death because Jesus paid for it on the cross. See, that's what this whole story is about. Now, I haven't got into all the symbolism. Let's look at it. Do you see the Old Testament drama here fulfilled in the New Testament? On the day the lambs would be tied to the altar, Jesus was nailed to the cross. Isn't it amazing? While they're over there symbolically tying lambs to the altar, still doing what would just take care of one year, a little ways away there in Jerusalem, Jesus was being nailed on the cross. The one time, perfect lamb that would permanently take away the sin. Not just for you. And by the way, a lot of people are trying, Christian groups are trying to go back and offer those lamb sacrifices again. My friend, you put Christ to shame in the world. I know some Christian Messianic groups are offering lamb. They want to offer sacrifices again. My friend, then Jesus died for nothing. For doing that. We don't have to go back and offer those sacrifices. Jesus paid our sin. He was finished on the cross. Here's some of the lessons we learned from Jesus' triumphant entry. Here's where we'll give you a lot of symbolism we see in this story today. As he rode in on the 10th day of Nisan RV, that first month of the year travel. Which, by the way, that usually is March or April on our calendar. Again, based upon the lunar cycle and how they figure into the calendar. But it's usually, Passover and our week of Easter or Passion Week is usually pretty close to it. First of all, verse 28, Jesus' presentation of himself. He presents himself. He comes riding in. This is the city, remember Jerusalem, the city that the apple of God's eye. It's the place where Abraham met Melchizedek. Which Melchizedek is a type, a shadow of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Salem back there in the book of Genesis. It was where many of God's prophets had spoken and ministered there in Jerusalem. It was the home of Israel's throne before it was the divided kingdom, then Judah's throne, but still, by all accounts, all of the 12 tribes would consider the home, the headquarters, Jerusalem. And Jesus rides into this place to present himself, his willingness to be that lamb to the Jewish people, the Lamb of God. Second thing we see in verses 29 and 30 is Jesus' power over that colt. Well, you need that colt was a young animal. It says here that one had never, a colt, tied that no one has ever sat. I mean, that's included in the scripture for a reason. To show the power, the authority of Jesus Christ over creation. You normally just couldn't hop up on the back of this young donkey and ride it. Well, what was he saying by riding that? In fact, when there was a new king that was named, like, do you remember back when Solomon named his son as the new king? They went and got this colt. They went and got this king's colt. One of his colts, and they put his son on that colt, Solomon, and And they said, and they rode him around, and as they rode him through the nation, as they rode him through the city, it was a statement. Here's your new king. Here's your new king. He's on the king's colt. Nobody else rides this colt. This was a colt that nobody else could ride. Isn't it amazing that Jesus is the kind of king that nobody else could be? He's not riding on the last king's colt. He's riding on the colt nobody could ride. And nobody had ridden. And Jesus comes riding into the city, fulfilling Zechariah 9:9, fulfilling that prophecy that tells us that he is never, never to be challenged. There is no king greater than him. There is no God greater than him. We'll see a little bit later where it says there's no other name. And we have to get him on the end because somebody else could be clever. Look at this. This was a virgin donkey, a colt never ridden or broken. I told you earlier, I've ridden broken, unbroken animals. That's kind of dangerous. They'll break you if you're not careful. When the king went forth to battle, he rode upon a horse. Now get this symbolism. When he went into a battle, a fight, he came riding a horse. When Jesus came, and if anyone came riding a donkey, they came, he was showing they came in peace. See, Jesus was emphasizing that he had the right to be a king, but he came in peace. He didn't come to destroy the world. He came to offer himself as a sacrifice. Which, by the way, the world couldn't take Jesus. And they remember he said, when they came to arrest him in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, you know, when they said, "Ruling for Jesus of Nazareth," he said, "I am," and they all fell on the ground. Jesus said, "Hey, guys, get up. We got to get this done. You know, all these soldiers, get up. Come here. Finish your job. Come on, arrest me." Because the Bible says he laid his life down. He came in peace. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world, set him free from this responsibility. But he came riding a donkey. He could be the king, but he came in peace. Please understand that. He came to offer you grace, forgiveness. But friends, I hear people today say, "Isn't Jesus just all about love and all about grace?" Yeah, he came that way. But when he comes back, he's not coming as a little lamb. He's coming as a lion. He's coming back, and in Revelation says he's riding on that white horse to take control, to take over. Don't miss that. Right now, you can know it in your spirit. But one day, if you don't deal with God, you're going to have to deal with him as a lion, a king, a warrior. And so, he offers his peace to God. Look at that little donkey. There's a big donkey and a little donkey in that right picture. You notice something about those three little donkeys right there? Something that every donkey has? He's got a cross mark on him. Every donkey has a cross mark on him. Symbol of, I believe, the beast of burden. I believe that the animal that carries the cross. Every donkey has a cross mark on it. If he's ripped wood and not something else, it changes the metaphor or something. How do you think on their white board is still on the mark? I just think it's unique. A lot of people haven't seen that or really thought about that. But that's a mark, a permanent mark on the donkey. But I believe God put that out. Jesus' purpose is above all. Verses 31 through 34. Jesus is faithfully preparing his disciples for his work. Notice the story. Let's look at something else about this story. He sends two of his disciples up there to get the donkey, the little donkey. He sends them up there and he prepares them. He says, "There may be some guys there and they may ask you why you want them. Tell them the Lord has need of them." Isn't it amazing that Jesus says every detail, knows every detail? I'm amazed. People sometimes act like, "Well, Jesus just, you know, I heard some crazy statements. Didn't know what he was doing, didn't understand what he was doing." I'm here to tell you, Jesus knew what those guys were going to ask, and Jesus knew when there was a fish swimming down the river that had a coin in his mouth that would pay their taxes. He knew all the details. And that tells me that there's not anything in your life or my life that's too big are the two little ones. He knows all the details. Take it to him. Talk to him about those things. But here Jesus, it's a picture of Jesus preparing his disciples for the work. The owners of the colt had to make a decision themselves. They had to decide if they were going to give what they had to the Lord. They had something in their hands, the possession of this little colt. Were they going to let it go? Were they willing to give it to God? Can I say to you, you've got some things in your hands. And you have to decide whether or not you're going to give it to God. Let God use it. Let God have it. Well, I don't have much, preacher. Well, I'm going to tell you, if you've got a voice, God can use it. If you've got a part, God might want to use that sometime. If you've got some time, God can sure use that. If you've got a heart, and people that need some love. There's a lot of things you've got you can give God if you would be willing to give to God. But you've got to open your hands and let it go. See, these guys were willing to let what they have go to God. I'm not asking for what they have. But I'm telling you, there's going to be times that God wants you to go that extra mile. If God wants you to give him something. I love that story where Moses is going before Pharaoh, and he tells God, says, God, I don't know how they're going to believe in me, how Pharaoh's going to think I've got power. Well, one of those stories when he goes before Pharaoh, he says, just do this. He said, take that wood staff in your hand, throw it down, it'll turn into a snake. And then after I show you what I'm going to do with it, he actually eats up some of the other magic snakes. He says, just reach down, take it by the tail, pick it back up. Well, let me tell you something. If I had a stick, I could probably throw it down and watch it turn into a snake, but I'm not sure I got enough faith to pick it back up. I'm not sure I won't pick it back up. But I think that story, what do you have in your hand that you're willing to give God? What can you give God? Do you ever ask yourself that question? Sometimes people looking for a church home, and they visit around the different churches, and they want to see what church has the most to offer them. Instead of maybe looking and seeing what church so we can give them an opportunity to give something to God. It's about you being involved in ministry. It's about you finding a place to serve. It's about you finding the blessings of God. Church is not like a cafeteria where you just go to see who gives you the most stuff. Some people want to go where they got the loudest music, or somebody wants to go where they got the biggest youth group, or somebody wants to go where they got the most children, or the biggest building to play in, or the most money to go to camp. You ever think about what you can give God? These guys, God, they have something God wants. I believe there was something better blessed to let that happen to you. And we have to decide if we're willing to give God those things that he gave us blessed. Number four, Jesus was praised from the people in verses 35 and 36. You see that when Jesus praised the Lord, some of them put their clothes on the donkey, showed their passion for God. They showed their love for Jesus. Here, they don't even want him to have a rough ride on the donkey. So they want that to be comfortable. It's just one way they could show they love him. Just like the woman who poured out the smelling ointments and all and washed his feet and cared for him and ministered to him. It was a way to show that she loved him. These people put their clothes on the back of the donkey as a way to show they love him. Some put their clothes after the donkey was full and covered the road with them so there'd be a soft road for the donkey to walk. So the first group maybe was just wanting to show their passion. The second group, who would allow the people and the donkey and everybody to walk on their clothes, may have been showing that their possessions were not as important as God's. They were willing to take their valuable clothes and throw it on the ground to just show God that they've chosen between their two masters, between God and mammon. They chose God. Sometimes God wants to know, what is your God? Do you got it? Or is it your goal? Is it your paycheck? Do you compromise for money? Some were waving palm branches as they used to honor a potentate returning from battle, where there's no greater potentate than Jesus Christ, the Lord for King Jesus. He's the King above all kings. The Bible says, in that day, he shall cry out, it'll be known that he is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. You're either going to acknowledge him as the King of kings and the Lord of lords here, or one day every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You're going to do that. You're either going to do it now and experience his grace, or you're going to do it later and experience his judgment. If you will do it, want to or not. The crowd shouted Hosanna, which means give salvation now. As they walked down the street and the crowd shouted, John reported this. It didn't report it in Luke's gospel. John chapter 12 said this about it. It said, the next day a great multitude, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took palm branches and trees and went out to meet him, and they cried out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Hosanna, give salvation now. The giver of salvation. You may remember when Jesus was born and they took him there into the temple. They referred to him as the God of salvation. Salvation of Israel is complete now. And we think of that today and we're reminded that there is no other name under heaven. Acts chapter 4, verse 12 says, there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. There's no other name to call on. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That comes out of Psalm 118, verse 26 or 28. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. He said, come in the name of somebody who came in the name of God. He was the King of kings and Lord of lords. King of Israel. He brings salvation. There's salvation in no other name. Watch this video and kind of show the woman I went in that day in a couple of minutes. Watch that. Story tells us a little bit more about the Lord as he comes in riding there and his preeminence above all others. And that's number 5, Jesus' preeminence above all others. Verses 35 and 36, let's reread it. It says here, Then they brought him to Jesus. Then they brought him to Jesus, and they threw their clothes on the poles, and they sat on him. And as they went in, spread their clothes along the way. Again, shouted Hosanna. I think I didn't change that verse. That was actually verse 38 or 39. I'm just confirming that. But it comes, as I said, out of Psalm 118, verse 26. It was a, Psalm 118 was a song that was sung by the Jewish people as they thought back to how God had liberated them from the penalty of death in Egypt, and really were, as they sang about the Passover, as they sang about God's deliverance and all that God had done for them. And it was a song of celebration. And in that song, he says, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Again, I just repeated in the New Testament, Acts 4:12, talking about knowing the name of the heaven, given on me before we went to the table. Again, tying together the Lamb of the Old Testament, the Lamb of the New Testament. Jesus, number six, Jesus' criticism by the Pharisees. We're going to get one more after this. Verse 39, the Pharisees rejected the position of King Jesus. What was his position? What do I mean by that? Let me read verse 39, please. Some of the Pharisees called to him in the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." When I say his position, I mean the position of many of them calling him king, savior, or one who brings salvation. Call them down. You're not the king. And don't let them say such things. You're not God. You're not the leader of this nation. And yet they did not understand him. That he could call the angels on earth. That he was a rightful heir to the throne of Israel. That was King Jesus. That was who was right in front of him. And they missed him. Why did they miss him? Because his position hindered their position. They had great respect. They were the clog that said nobody can come to God without them. They had to stand in the way. People really know God. And so they rejected his position of supreme, sovereign God. They rejected the praise of Jesus as Lord. The word Lord means he's the king, he's the master, he's the boss. We'll get our word out of an eye, and it just means that he's in one. If they're praising him as Lord, he's the master. They rejected that. They rejected the people's relationship with Jesus. They rejected the fact that they loved him, that they elevated him, that they lauded him, they celebrated him. And they didn't do that to them. They held their position over the heads of the people. And then they rejected a plan that limited the need for them. You see, Jesus was going to rip the veil of the temple. No longer did you have to go to a priest. The priest then would take your sacrifice and go to God for you. No longer were the people going to have to go through a priest to get to God. That eliminated them. That was something they were more afraid of than anything. And yet, that plan scared them. Because the people could go to God, and they would have no need, and they would have no position. Today, I want you to know something. You may be watching this program tonight, and somebody told you that you have to go to somebody else to get forgiveness of your sins, or you have to get this person to make intercession for you. I'm here to tell you, you can go straight to God. You don't have to go to some priest. God has opened the way for you. And by the way, there's always a criticism right there. Jesus' criticism about the Pharisees, he faced it all the time. People like to say, "We're Jesus when everybody loved him," and we didn't. In fact, some places were divided. Some so much so that it turned the children against the parents, and brothers against sisters. And so he faced criticism. We faced criticism today. We realize that's part of it. If you follow Christ, you will be hating that son. Okay. And then last of all, Jesus' creation to proclaim his glory. His creation could proclaim his glory, verse 40. I love what it says. It says, "But he answered and said to him, I tell you that if these people were crying out, please, It may very well be there for them. It may very well be stone that they're looking at right here. Would immediately begin to cross. If there is no one to, if man is not smart enough to worship his creator, the creation is smart enough. What Jesus is saying. Romans 8 says that the whole of creation groans to be delivered. Creation is kind of under a curse right now. All the way back to the book of Genesis, that God put a curse on it because of the fall of man and the sin of sins of Adam and Eve there, and God cursed the ground that it would produce thorns and thistles, no more. Prior to that, there were no thorns, and now there are thorns and thistles and briars and all those things, and the creation is under that curse, but they don't like being under that curse because it hinders them being everything God created them to be. I just wonder if in the last days, when the new heaven and the new earth, if the rocks will not cry out, if the trees will not clap their hands. Yeah, I don't understand it all. I just know that Jesus says to us here, the stone could cry out. And if we don't, if we're not smart enough to do that, he says they are. That may be where we got the saying, dumber than a rock. You know, if we don't know how to worship God, it rocks us. And so, what do you think about that? Do you elevate God? Do you worship Him? Do you love Him? And I'm here to tell you something. Jesus, this story goes on and talks about how He wept over Jerusalem, how He wanted to draw them to Him like a mother draws her chicks, but they would. Because of that, he turned his attention from the Jewish people to the Gentile people. Still loved the Jewish people. He would still not turn a Jewish person away from being saved, but he knew his work, his mission, his great commission, the majority of the Jewish people would not say. So he turned to the church, made up of people of all tribes and nations and colors and races and all this that could be a part of a new covenant, a new church. And one day in the tribulation period, he's going to come back and work with the Jewish people, give them another chance to be an important part of his kingdom. I pray that most of the Jewish people, the Bible says, pray for peace in Jerusalem. I pray that most of the Jewish people will be saved. The Bible says many of Israel will be saved in those last days. And right now, right now, God's calling. This week, we ought to be thinking about the call of God. This whole march up to Jerusalem is just promoting, symbolizing, elevating God's plan, God's calling. To be a sacrifice, to pay for your sins, the thing that keeps you out of heaven, the thing between you and God, your sin, God says, I'm willing to remove that wall. Jesus came and gave himself as a lamb to remove that wall. Especially if you're young. You can pray and ask Christ to come into your heart and give your sin and your soul. Commit yourself to following you, God of God. Wanting to be like Christ. Telling you sorry for your sin. Ask you to come into your life and forgive you. Oh, my God. God bless you. And this Passion Week shows you just how passionate God is for you. We love you here at Ouachita. If you need a place to serve, look for a church that will love on you. This is that place. This is the place, no matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter what you've been, what you've been through, you want a place to stop it. This is that place. I call it a healing place. A place that you can bring prophets. Find the healing that is God for you to me. This Sunday morning, 10:45, we're going to have an outdoor drive-up Easter service. You can come, stay in the car, bring you some donuts and coffee. Don't be getting out and going shaking hands with other people because the state has said we can do this. We just need to remain separate. Don't get out and shake hands with those other people. You can sit in the car and wave at them. Let's honor the authority. God bless you, your honor, and your father. Bless you, God, this week. Bless you, enjoy this time again. Remember, the Lisby family's gonna be here with us this Sunday. They're gonna be doing the singing for us. Maybe they'll share a little bit. But, and then when we conclude, we're gonna have communion or Lord's Supper. All done. Just right. Rubber gloves, everything clean, making sure there's no germs or viruses. And we'll have that for you today. Okay? Looking forward to being with us this week. Don't forget. Hey, if you pray with me, if you pray with Jesus Christ, we'd like to send you some free information. Just send it to office at WatchtowerBaptist.org. And we'll make sure that that information, we'll get that information sent out to you. And some way we can pray for you. You can probably send it to that email address, or you can call the office 387-6372. We can do that all to them before. We're not there, we can message. We're kind of on a skeleton schedule right now, but we'll be back in a second. Okay? God bless you. Thanks for joining us tonight. And right here from the theological desk, Ouachita Baptist Church, we're glad you got the theology report for this guy. Theology.